One and a half down, two to go. How many of you are a tween? Alright. Wow. I guess there was a 21 and over that could be on that one. Alright, how many of you have seen one Twilight movie? How many of you thought that one Twilight movie was the greatest movie you've ever saw in your life? How many of you had a young niece or nephew or cousin between the ages of 12 and 7, 8 and 17 who thought it was the greatest movie that she ever saw in her life? Alright, I don't know. I'm not either of those. So, let's bring come here, excuse me. So, this young doctoral woman. She has actually presented several times as well here in the past. She's talked about the psychology of eating disorders, and she has of course talked about why Edward and Jacob and Bella are so close and so far away. And because so many people seemed so intrigued and just couldn't get enough of Kristen Stewart's life, we thought we should revisit it again. So, why tell us why Bella just cannot resist Edward?
Again, to really try and get to the bottom of why it is that Bella cannot resist Edward. Now, it sounds like most of you are familiar with Twilight, but is there anybody in this room who actually still doesn't really know what's going on?
Yeah!
Thank you. So, for the benefit of the uninitiated, I'm just going to go through very quickly, you know, catch you up. Basically, the Twilight series is a series of books written by a woman called Stephanie Meyer, who is now a very, very rich woman called Stephanie Meyer. They star, the films star, an actress called Kristen Stewart, who plays a character called Bella Swan, and an actor called Robert Pattinson, who plays a sexy vampire called Edward Cullen. There's also another person in the movies. This guy's name is Jake. He begins the series looking like this, but then turns into this. Picking up a few female fans on the way. And now what I want to do is just take you through very quickly all the books of Twilight so you can understand the plot. You're busy people, we don't have long, so I'm going to move quite fast. Do you think you can handle it? Yeah. Okay, so we're just going to do the bottom line here. So book one, there's a shy girl, she meets a sexy vampire. She thinks he doesn't fancy her, but actually he does, but he won't date her because he's worried he'll drink her blood by accident. Observational habit. Now, they do eventually get together, but then some other vampires try and kill her, but it all turns out okay in the end. Moving on to the second book. In this one, the sexy vampire actually dumps the shy girl. She's really bummed out by this, but she cheers up a bit when she gets to hang out with her childhood friend Jake, who happens to turn into a super hot werewolf. So that's good. The other vampires do try and kill her again, but it's actually sort of good because it freaks out the sexy vampire and then they get back together. Now, the third book, I actually missed out by accident in the last talk, so I'm sorry about that, but I've done some extensive research on the plot, and this is basically what's involved. Big fight, good one to take the boyfriend to. Book four, Breaking Dawn, in this one they get married, they have sex, which is great because the sexual tension has been building now for some time. It's a lot of ages. And then some really, really weird stuff happens. Now, if you want to find out what weird stuff is, you're a little late because the first movie from Breaking Dawn already came out, but the second one is due out on the 16th of November. So you might want to get your tickets for that. Okay, so the interesting thing about Twilight, though, is it really is a global phenomenon. So you can see lots of people are really kind of obsessed by it. So this woman on the left has pictures of Edward Cullen, all over the world. The woman on the right has written "Bite Me on the Face" because she is so into him. It's not just Edward, people are very into Bella, Kristen Stewart too. These fans are coming out to meet her. The guy on the right there is absolutely positive that he calls Kristen Stewart. He thinks he's going home with her. You know, as with all kind of important political debates, you can, you know, buy clothing to express your allegiance. So this woman is demonstrating that she thinks Jacob is a better boyfriend than Edward. Now, the thing about Twilight is, even though it is targeted at teen girls, it has also attracted the attention of a lot of people who really should know a lot better. Another interesting thing is that there's lots of blogs that you can get that are kind of surrounding Kristen Stewart, Rob Patterson. This is actually one of my favourites. It's called Rob Manipulations. You might not be sure what this is. It actually means to manipulate an image of Robert Pattinson with skillful hands. And that's what it says on the website. And what this actually comes down to is a lot of pictures of Robert Pattinson's head on other people's bodies. Which is actually a lot more entertaining than you would think it would be. So I recommend that one. Now you can get your Twilight associated merchandise too. So you can get Twilight condoms here, which is quite ironic, because Edward doesn't believe in sex before marriage. You can also get this thing. I don't know what it is. But apparently a lot of fans have complained because they say Edward is actually a lot bigger than this. Now, I'm not going to mention 50 Shades of Grey too much because I know that's going to come up in the next talk, but one of the interesting things about this is that the woman who wrote it actually initially came up with the idea as some Twilight fan fiction. And there's some speculation that they might make a film of this book. I saw some kind of suggestion on the internet that maybe Ryan Gosling might be playing the role, but I can't see any evidence, any kind of source of where they got that. So I think maybe just a lot of women really, really want to be spanked by Ryan. So when we kind of look at the evidence, it really makes you wonder why. What is it about the Twilight saga which has captured everyone's imagination? And I think the answer really is in the love story between Bella and Edward, and particularly in Bella's passion for Edward. And of course, what you do when you're not sure about someone, I'm not sure about Edward, because frankly, he does a lot of things which don't seem that great. So I wanted to find out more about Edward, and what you do in this day and age when you're not sure about someone is you Google them. with a blue jean. That's right. That makes sense if you did the trivia, and otherwise you think I'm just strange for pointing that out. So I googled Edward, and I came up with something quite interesting. This is actually what I found. Edward Cullen is actually on OkCupid. Bella might want to have a word with him about that, if it's all of you, to be honest. So let's go through the profile then and see if we can find out why she is so obsessed with him. We'll start with the age, 109. Well, you know, they say good things about older men, but that's a little pushing the boundaries for me. What's he doing with his life? 12th grade biology again. It's a little strange. Why is it taking so long to pass 12th grade biology? Favourite food, blood. A little strange. And I don't know if I like that photo too much either. You know, there's a head on stare. The OkCupid blog says that's very intimidating to women. But you know, maybe he has some other photos up. Maybe we should take a look, see if you know they're more attractive. Okay, so what about this one? Well, I mean, it's nice he's close to his family, you know, he's close to his friends, but I don't know if I want to hang out with them. Yeah, I'm not sure about that one. Well, let's see, let's look at the next one instead. Okay. I think he's definitely cut a girl out of the photo there. I don't think that's cool. I think it's a bit tacky, actually. But maybe he can redeem it with the last photo, because he has got another one up too. Schoolboy error. No girls like those naked chest shots. I'm sorry. I feel that we can't really tell from Edward's profile what the source of his appeal is. You know, I mean, would you message this man? Some people would, others wouldn't. And so I think either way, what's really needed is probably a more systematic scientific approach, and that's what I'm going to try and give you now. Okay, so we're going to start by talking about Edward's first qualities and why they might be attracted to Bella, and then we're going to move and talk about juicy flesh, his kind of inner qualities, and then finally finish with some of the inner reasons, which I think are really what's driving her attraction. So first, the glossy surface. Now, it's known that women do find height to be an attractive quality in men. And if we look at how Bella and Edward's heights compare here, you can see that Bella is around 5'4". She's a little taller here because she has Barbie hair. but she's 5'4", take it from me. And here's Edward. He is actually substantially taller. He's 6'2". So could this perhaps be one of the reasons why she's attracted to him? I mean, there is some evidence that taller men are less likely to be single and more likely to have children. And here is a graph that shows it. But more importantly, think about Will Smith. He's 6'2". He has a wife and 3 children, so what more proof do you need? And then you clearly realise that this is attractive to women, and I'm sorry, but you do lie about your height. So I think this is quite nicely illustrated by some data from OkCupid. Now, if you look at... Oh, my lines disappeared. You're right, Max Arkrath. No, I don't think that at all. I don't want to be recorded as saying that anyway. Okay, what this is meant to show is 2 lines, and what you can see in the graph that you're going to imagine in your mind is a slope for the US men distribution, which averages at 5'9". But for the OkCupid men, they average at 5'11". So, either everyone on OkCupid is very tall, or there's a little bit of a nudge. So could this then be the explanation for why Bella is known to Edward? Well, there's actually a problem with this theory, which is that Jake, at least in the book, is actually taller than Edward. So there must be more to this. It can't just be about the height. So here's another candidate. Maybe it's because Edward is really strong. And to illustrate this, I'd like to show you a quick clip from the first movie. So here she's hanging out in a car park. He's staring at her funny, that happens a lot. Amazing, right? You know, she saved him from a hurtling truck and he left this big dent in it. He's really, really strong. The strength theory, which is that he actually has competition from Jacob's blossoming biceps, which arrive in the second film. He can lift motorbikes and he can do all kinds of things. He's also very strong. But perhaps the reason why Bella still fancies Edward over Jacob could be something to do with the inverted U hypothesis. So I'm now going to describe a psychological study to you in which they showed women a succession of men of varying muscularity. So this was a toned man, this was a built man, this was a brawny man, this is their labels, not mine. They all didn't have any heads. I think that was an important part of the experiment. And then they asked how likely it was that this man would be sexually exciting, would be a good sexual partner, etc. And they found that the data formed an inverted U-shape. So the brawny men were thought to be reasonably sexually attractive, definitely more sexually attractive than the chubby, headless men. But the ones who did best were those in the middle, like Edward, the toned man. So perhaps this could be a reason why Bella is preferring Edward to Jake. Now, another surface quality of Edward that's mentioned quite a lot is his eyes. When Edward is hungry, his eyes go very black. Now, I can't actually see how this could be an attractive feature, because pupils dilate when you're sexually attracted to someone. However, what I don't understand is the fact that when he's satiated, they go bright yellow. Now, I don't know about you, but I think of yellow eyes generally to be a bad thing. You may be jaundiced, you may be going to a hospital, so I don't understand why that would be attractive to Bella. This woman has yellow eyes, you know, she's got nice hair. She's got a cute hat, but I am not sexually attracted. Anyway, so I don't understand what it is about the eyes. I also don't understand what it is about the sparkles. So for those of you who aren't aware, Edward is actually a very sparkly person. And this is him revealing himself to Bella for the first time in his full sparkliness. And here he is. This comes a bit later on. He's revealing himself to the vampire royalty in Italy as a way to make them kill him. It's a long story. You need to read the book. I don't know what it is about the sparkliness that's sexually attractive. You know, possibly it's something to, you know, similar to the thing that happens with peacock feathers. But I looked quite hard, and I actually thought the sexuality. I mean, who would want to be blinded by their own boyfriend? So I think we need to look a little further, to go really into this image of Edward. And let's start with intelligence. Now, there is some evidence in the Twilight saga that Edward is quite intelligent. So in the first movie, they hang out in a biology class and they name all the parts of a plant. Although you really would hope that, with the amount of time that he has been through 12th grade biology at the time. But there is also more evidence, which is that he can play the piano and write songs. And there is actually a scene in the first movie where he writes Bella a song, and he plays it on the piano. And I was going to show it to you, but it actually made me feel quite nauseous. I thought I'd spare you with that. But I thought I would show you. I discovered today you can actually buy the sheet music for Edward's song for Bella. And it looks fairly basic in my mind, but I think, you know, there are at least two parts which look quite obvious. So I think on that, Edward is pretty intelligent. Another thing that people mention about Edward is his smell. He actually smells very, very good. And to illustrate this, I'd actually like to read a quick passage from one of the books. It is quite erotic, you know, it's a little bit exciting. Do you think you can handle it? Oh, I sense some nervousness. You're not sure you can handle it, but I think you can. So, you get passages like this. Blood boiled beneath my skin, burned my lips. My breath came in a wild gasp. My fingers knotted in his hair, clutching him to me. My lips parted as I breathed in his heady scent. So he smells pretty damn good. And there is suggests maybe a mechanism for this. So when animals are feeling quite horny, they emit these things called pheromones, which are sensed by the other animals, and, great when they have sex and things. And you can actually buy pheromones on the internet if you want to spray them on yourself. But the question is, really, is there any evidence that pheromones work in humans? And there actually is a little bit. So in this study, they used this chemical, which I can't pronounce, which is actually a metabolite of testosterone. And they got these women to sniff it from a glass jar. And they also got them to sniff a control substance, which was just sort of a whiffy, other kind of yeasty smell. And they measured their sexual arousal afterwards. Control substance, not much going on. But for this testosterone metabolite, you can see there was a substantial increase in sexual arousal. Is they actually did use a huge amount of this thing that I can't pronounce. But I don't think it's implausible to think that, you know, maybe Edward has a lot of these chemicals because he is a vampire, he's not a normal man. So maybe this is what could slightly be going on. However, I still don't think we've really found the answer. I think we need to go further. We need to go into the inner core of Bella's attraction to Edward. And there's a couple of things which I think could be going on here. Now, some of you may have heard of a substance called dopamine. It's actually a neurotransmitter in the brain. And it's released in response to kind of motivating, rewarding, pleasurable things. Drugs of abuse, like other dopamine pathways, you know, foods. I've put some of my favourite foods up here to illustrate. I've also put one of my mother's favourite foods, indeed the durian. I don't know if any of you have tasted the durian, but I think it's one of the most disgusting things that on the earth. But my mother finds them really rewarding, so probably her dopamine pathways are lighting up. Sex is quite rewarding. And obviously Bella finds Edward quite rewarding, so she's probably getting a good dopamine response to Edward. The thing with dopamine, though, is the response can fade over time. However, there were two surefire ways to get those dopamine neurons tingling, and both of which I think Edward does pretty well. So one of the ways is to have new types of reward. And if you think about it, this is what happens at the beginning of a relationship, and it's definitely what happens with Edward. When he first is introduced to Bella, he's just kind of hanging out looking sexy, that's quite rewarding. And then he starts kind of flirting with her and showing he's attracted to her, that's another type of reward. Then she gets to snog him. So that's pretty good, more dopamine being released there. Now there's another way to keep dopamine going, and that is to make the rewards intermittent and unpredictable. And Edward is really, really good at this. So when he first meets Bella, he can't even look at her. So this is not a big sign that a reward from Edward is coming on her way. And then he, flirts with her, they get together. Then out of absolutely nowhere, he dumps her. She wasn't expecting that. And then they get back together. So Edward is actually completely unreliable and a very intermittent reward. Of course, there is another way to get dopamine neurons tingling, and that is rewards which are both new and intermittent. And some of you may have seen this picture before. It's actually Kristen Stewart who's been caught in flagrante with the director of her film Snow White and the Huntsman. Now, I guess he would qualify as a new reward. It's probably pretty intermittent because they shouldn't really be doing this out in the open. So, could it be possible that he's kind of doing Edward and she's acting like a real-life Bella? I think it's possible. But you may be wondering, is this really all down to dopamine? Can we really put it down to this neurotransmitter? Well, there is some proof, at least, that dopamine is involved in some way. And it's from a cute little animal called the prairie vole. She's cute, right? Now, what normally happens in a prairie vole life is that a prairie vole will meet another prairie vole, and they will... it's not a mirror reflection of the same prairie vole, it's a different prairie vole. Okay, so they will meet each other, and they will mate. And they'll fall in love. That's how it goes. However, if you inject a prairie vole with a drug that increases dopamine in its nuclear circumference, and I feel I should point out at this point, this isn't a prairie vole, this is a triple. which I'm not sure whether you're familiar with. They're very cute, so I put them in. Now, if you inject a prairie gull, or probably indeed a tribble, with dopamine, and then you introduce it to another prairie gull or tribble, you will find that they will then fall in love. So I think this is some proof of the power of dopamine. I think Edward also has another strange thing on his side, and that is the power of fear. So if you think about it, right from the beginning of their relationship, Bella experiences a whole load of really scary things which she connects with Edward. So first she nearly gets killed by a car and he saves her. Then he reveals himself to be a vampire. That's pretty scary. Then at some point she nearly gets killed by this vampire, who I don't think is at all scary. I don't know what you think, I just think he has a really kind face. So I don't know, he's getting cast in these bad roles. Now you would think that all this fear would put her off, wouldn't you? But actually there seems to be some evidence that fear can get confused with lust. Which I think will also be going on a little bit in Shades of Grey, so bear that in mind. So I just want to tell you the results of this one study where they used this scary looking device called a vaginal photoplethysmograph. What this does is to measure the engorgement of one's lady parts. And so they hooked women up to this thing and then they showed them erotic videos. They may not have been as tough. Maybe they were, I don't know. So they showed them these erotic videos, but they had two different conditions. So in one, before they showed the erotic video, they showed an anxiety-provoking video, which was called something like threatened amputation, which does sound pretty nasty. And then the control condition, they just showed them these nice pictures of landscapes and things like that. And what they found was that in the anxious condition, the women actually showed more blood volume than they did in the neutral condition. Oops. So that's maybe some suggestion that there's kind of an arousal that can be created by anxiety, although obviously it's a lot more complicated than that. Okay, now there is also some evidence, interestingly, from animals that this could also be going on. I want to tell you about one study to illustrate this. Something I've noticed in our academic presentations lately is that people will just cut and paste a title from a journal and just put it in their presentation. I think that's quite lazy. Unless the title of the paper is Male Toki Antelope Alarm Snort Deceptively to Retain Female's Amazing. Then I think you're really duty bound to cut and paste that. But what they basically did in this paper was they did this cool study where they observed antelopes in Kenya, and they saw a lot of this going on. So you can see the antelope at the back there, the male antelope, is snorting deceptively, suggesting that there's a cheetah or a lion that's going to come and eat them. And then this woman at the front is really bothering it. She's like really scared. She thinks it's a predator. She's, you know, cowering a little bit. And then this. Okay, so I think I've given you some reasons why I think Bella might be so into Edward, but I think there's actually a little bit of Bella in all of us. We all have dopamine neurons, you know, they're an exaggeration, but I think there's a little bit of Bella in all of us here. But because I'm a scientist, I actually want to quantify this. And I want to know from you, who would you most like to date? Or if you don't swing that way, you know, who would you most like to have a beer with? So I've told you about Edward and Jake, but there is another guy in Twilight who's been cruelly so far omitted from my presentation. His name is Eric. Eric is president of the chess club, so he's perhaps maybe a little bit more nerdy than the other two. So by show of applause, could I just get an idea of how many of you would go for Edward? Oh! Yeah. Interesting. I've got the turning of the tide because he's pretty popular in the last one. What about Jake? times. It's an interesting cultural barometer. And what about Eric? Of all these men, you know, who would be the ideal man. So obviously we need to start with Jake's torso. I think that's only fair. I wasn't sure what to do about legs, but when Jake's a werewolf, he can run pretty fast. So we'll keep his legs. Also, maybe Robert Pattinson's pretty face. So he's looking pretty good so far, I think he'll agree. Now, when Edward is a vampire, he can fly. That's actually pretty useful. So maybe we'll keep that too. But I really think we saw the most love for Eric. So I think what's really missing from this beautiful creature is the brains of a nerd. So let's give Eric's brains. Then I think we really have created the perfect man. So I'm very happy to answer any questions, and if you'd like to read more, you can get this book called The Psychology of Twilight, which I have a chapter in. There's more chapters about all these other interesting things here. Thank you.
Not seen either of these movies now. How many of you are going to rush home tonight and put that first in your Netflix queue? All right. What psychology or physiological questions do we have for our presenters this evening? This evening, I'm drunk. Nothing? Really? You're all okay. Yeah. Foreigner guy. That's why. I'm sorry.
Have you seen any of the
riff
tracks of Twilight?
Have you seen any of the riff tracks of Twilight? She seems to have a puzzled look on her face.
I don't know what a riff track is.
Okay, riff tracks,
R-I-F-T-R-A-X.
Okay, the website. You know Mystery Science Theater 3000?
I haven't understood any of what you said, but it sounds really interesting.
I'll explain to you later. Yeah. Do studies of animal sex in the wild really properly map to on-screen chemistry, or is it just a supposition, an exaggeration for a crowd such as you all?
What he said. I don't know if they do really. The thing with the prairie voles, though, I mean, they have done some fMRI studies in humans where they've kind of scanned people's brains when they're looking at their loved ones, and they find some kind of activation in reward areas, which kind of is where a lot of dopamine activity is going on. So there could be. But it's probably a little bit of a stretch, just for you guys.
Go ahead.
From your scientific point of view, is there any possible way that vampires
may actually exist? That's a good question.
Well, I'm a very open-minded scientist, so I'm going to say yes.
Thank you. Round of applause. All right, we will take a... we'll take like a 1 second break and we will get to our final presentation of the evening about the history and cultural significance of romance.